had the hearing initially set for 2 days, and if it will go into tomorrow, but if it takes longer, we'll conclude the hearing. We'll go further than that. We won't reschedule that portion unless it's necessary for purposes of making a decision. I just wanted to note in beginning that to set give some history in the case so it's clear as to what brings us here. The offense occurred in this case on May 31, 2014. Ms. Geyser and Ms. Wire were both defendants in the case. All parties, the victim as well as the defendants, were very young at the time. Ms. Geyser was born on May 16, 2002. On October 5, 2017, Ms. Geyser entered a plea of guilty to count one of the information which alleged attempted first-degree intentional homicide party to the crime. There was an enhancer that was struck at the time. The enhancer was used by use of a dangerous weapon. By stipulation, the court accepted the various reports that had previously been ordered and received, and the court found the defendant first guilty. She entered a plea to the charge and then not guilty by reason of mental disease or defect based upon the reports that had been received. The court then committed her to the Department of Health and Human Services for preparation of predisposition reports. Reports were received and read, and then the sentencing hearing took place on February 1, 2018. At which time the court committed Ms. Geyser to the Department of Health Services for 40 years, finding that conditional release of Ms. Geyser would pose a significant risk of bodily harm to herself or of serious property damage. Prior to today, Ms. Geyser has filed two petitions for a conditional release, which were withdrawn before a hearing was scheduled, before a hearing took place. Ms. Geyser filed a current petition on January 17, 2024. As a result of that petition filing, the court ordered Dr. Brooke Lundbaum, Dr. Deborah Collins, and Dr. Kenneth Robbins to prepare reports. Those reports have been received and been reviewed by the court and read and reviewed by the parties. Court also received a letter report from the Department of Health Services at the Winnebago Mental Health Center that was dated February 20, 2024. Court has also received a brief and supportive conditional release as well as a proposed conditional release plan filed by Ms. Geyser's attorneys. Excuse me. Petitions for a conditional release may be filed after 6 months of the initial commitment petitions for a conditional release may be filed after 6 months of the initial commitment to institutional care, requesting the court to modify its order of institutional placement to conditional release, which is what the subject of today's hearing is. The state has the burden of proof by clear and convincing evidence that the commitment should continue. With that, then I'm prepared to proceed. Now, as I indicated, the state has the burden. Does the state wish to go first, or does Ms. Geyser's attorneys wish to go first?
I believe the state should go first, Judge, given that it is our burden, and I'm prepared to do that.
All right, then let's proceed.
The state would call Dr. Deborah Collins.
Yes, there's no need to sequester any witnesses, true?
True.
All right, very good. Dr. Collins, come forward. You have a seat behind the court reporter. When you step up, they'll stay standing. Raise your right hand. Our clerk will, you can step up. Our clerk will swear you in.
Do you swear that the testimony you're about to give in this matter before the court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Very good, thank you. Then the microphone is the bar with the red light on it. Just speak directly into that. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Doctor. I'm going to show you right away what's marked as State's Exhibit Number 1. Ask if you can identify that, please.
It's a 9-page copy of my professional resume.
You are a doctor, correct?
I'm a doctor of psychology, yes.
Okay. Can you tell the court your educational background prior to becoming a doctor of psychology?
In 1987, I was conferred a Bachelor of Arts degree from St. Norbert College here in Wisconsin. In 1992, I received a Master of Arts degree from Boston College. In 1995, I received a Master of Arts degree in Clinical Psychology from the University of Hartford in Connecticut. And then in 1998, I was conferred from that same institution a doctoral degree in clinical psychology.
Would it be fair to say, Doctor, that most of your professional career has been spent, however, in forensic psychology, or how would you characterize it?
Almost the entirety of my professional career since licensure in 99 has centered on forensic psychology.
And how does your doctorate in clinical fit into a career in forensic psychology?
The doctoral degree in clinical psychology is a generalist degree, if you will, and then I began to specialize in a subspecialty area of psychology late in my career, late in my education, if you will, so around 96, 97, and then pursued eventually board certification in the field.
Why did you choose the area of forensic psychology?
Because of the interest that I had in the areas, in the area where law and mental health intersect.
In addition to your doctorate in clinical psychology, do you hold any licenses or other professional, qualifications?
I'm licensed as a clinical psychologist in the states of Wisconsin and Michigan currently. Additionally, in 2005, I became board certified by the American Board of Forensic Psychology, and that's a credential that's held by about 370 psychologists in the nation.
And I'm sorry, when did you become accredited?
2005.
You're also a business owner, correct?
Yes.
And what businesses do you own?
I own Behavioral Consultants, Inc.
And you've owned that since when?
I've been a part owner for well over 15 years, and I've been the sole owner since approximately 2017.
And it's a part of that business that is represented by the Wisconsin Forensic Unit, is that right?
Behavioral Consultants is the parent company. The Wisconsin Forensic Unit is a division of that company.
And what is the Wisconsin Forensic Unit?
The Wisconsin Forensic Unit is a division in contract with the State Department of Health Services tasked with conducting competency to stand trial evaluations throughout Wisconsin's 72 counties.
And maybe you can describe for the court how much of Behavioral Consultants is made up of court-appointed work versus any private work that might be done?
I would say the vast majority of referrals would be court appointments, but there's also 30 to 40% which consist in referrals from attorneys, other agencies, and attorneys from both sides of the aisle, if you will.
And you've been doing all of this kind of work for at least 25 years?
Approximately, yes.
Throughout your career, would it be fair to say that you've done thousands of competency evaluations?
Yes.
And how about mental responsibility evaluations?
I would say a few thousand mental responsibility evaluations, lesser number than the number of competency stand trial evaluations.
And then would it be fair that there's lesser evaluations for conditional release?
Yes, I would say that number is in the hundreds.
And you, well, tell the court how you first became involved in the case with Morgan Geyser.
My initial involvement or engagement in the case was through, by being retained by Ms. Geyser's defense counsel.
And when did that occur?
That occurred within a couple of days following the arrest, the index offense in this case.
And that, you know, was May 31st of 2014?
Yes.
So within a few days of that, you were retained?
Yes.
And do you recall when you first met Morgan Geyser?
June 4th of 2014.
And where did that occur?
That occurred at the Washington County Juvenile Detention Center.
Can you describe for the court as much as you recall about your initial impressions of Morgan when you first met her?
My initial impressions included that Ms. Geyser was not well psychiatrically, that she had experienced trauma certainly in the commission of the offenses, and that she also presented as quite odd during the 2.5 hour interview I had with her. So her mannerisms were odd, her expressed emotions were inconsistent, sort of incongruous to what had occurred. At one point, she burst into tears when the threat of her Harry Potter friends not being present to her or coming back was broached.
What did you think when you first met her?
When I first met her, I was collecting data, if you will. I was observing her, talking with her, obtaining information. I wasn't immediately forming conclusions or opinions.
And you've met with Morgan many times over the course of the years, true?
Approximately a dozen.
Okay, and you've authored 7 reports to my count regarding Morgan?
Yes.
And I think we discussed this, but it really wasn't until the first petition for conditional release that you were court appointed, is that right?
Correct. I believe that's accurate.
All of that time being involved with Morgan prior to that first petition for release was as a result of being retained by the defense?
Yes.
Is that unusual at all in your experience throughout your career to have had that much contact with someone?
Over that span of time, almost 10 years, yes, I would say that's unique. It's not singular, but it's certainly unique.
There have been other cases that you've been involved for this similar length of time and perhaps had that much contact with someone?
There have been cases where I've been involved for that length of time, okay, but not necessarily as many contacts for so many different reasons over time.
And in this case, you did conduct a review of mental responsibility with Morgan, is that right?
Previously?
Yes.
Yes.
In fact, I think you authored a report November 2nd of, or thereabouts of 2016 related to mental responsibility.
Yes, November 2nd of 2016.
Okay. So you met her roughly in June of 14 and were asked to conduct a mental responsibility evaluation sometime in 16. So you had roughly 2 years of involvement before giving that opinion on mental responsibility, correct?
Correct.
And
describe again for the court ultimately what you concluded regarding Morgan's mental responsibility in this case.
I concluded to a reasonable degree of professional certainty that at the time of the index offense, so May 31st of 2014, she was suffering from a condition which would qualify as a mental disease or defect as broadly defined by the Wisconsin jury instructions. And I also concluded that because of symptoms of that condition, she was rendered to lack substantial capacity to appreciate wrongfulness or conform her conduct to the requirements of the law, and that there was support for her plea in this case.
And what was the mental condition that you diagnosed her as suffering from at that time?
As I recall, the mental condition was unspecified schizophrenia spectrum and other psychotic disorder.
Do you know at what point between June of 2014 and authoring that report in 2016 that you came to a diagnosis of unspecified schizophrenia spectrum?
I do not know precisely. It was a process, though. It wasn't a conclusion arrived at within a day or a month of contact with her, for example.
Can you describe that process for the court?
That process was careful and deliberate, involved consulting with the permission of counsel, with an expert on early onset psychotic symptoms or psychosis. It entailed use of multiple methods, so psychological testing, review of ample collateral records, including discovery material, mental health records, and then collateral interviews with each of Ms. Geyser's parents in person, and review of additional family medical records.
Had you been involved up to that point with anyone this young who perhaps would be diagnosed with schizophrenia?
I don't recall.
But at least this was unusual to you, that someone this young could be suffering from schizophrenia?
That someone this young could be suffering from psychotic symptoms and a psychotic spectrum disorder, yes.
I'm going to ask this because it's going to come up later, but I assume prior to doing that mental responsibility evaluation, you considered whether or not there was any malingering or falsifying of symptoms that were noticed with Morgan.
Yes.
And what was your conclusion then regarding any such malingering?
My conclusion was that the totality of information available weighed contrary to identifying her as malingering or faking or misapplying symptoms of psychosis at a time when she didn't have those.
After that mental responsibility evaluation in 2016, when was the next time you had contact with Morgan?
The precise date, I don't know. The occasion was for the purposes of the conditional release evaluation that followed her commitment to DHS and petition in 2022.
And the next report you had authored to the court was the one from August of 22 regarding conditional release?
Yes.
And just, well, briefly, what was your conclusion regarding the issue of conditional release in 2022?
It was my opinion, to a reasonable degree of professional certainty, that there was not support for her safe release to the community or her petition at that time.
And I guess I would ask if you can describe the process that you used to make that determination at that time, including the things you reviewed and considered.
In addition to, again, a clinical interview with Ms. Geyser, so direct contact with her, I also reviewed years of mental health records that had accrued during her treatment at the Winnebago Mental Health Institute. I reviewed the underlying complaint, and I also reviewed my records with my office pertaining to her.
And those records consisted of your work, but also the work of Dr. Lundbaum?
Yes.
And you became aware that after authoring your report in August of 22 that Ms. Geyser withdrew her petition for release?
Yes.
And you were next contacted in this case approximately a year later, again on the issue of conditional release?
Yes.
The process and the information that you described you reviewed for the August of 22 report, is that similar to every conditional release evaluation you're asked to make?
Yes, at least those types of information and sources are obtained. I believe in the context of the second conditional release evaluation, so 2023, I believe I also consulted with her treating psychiatrist. I would have to check my notes to confirm the accuracy of that memory.
And that would have been the psychiatrist at Winnebago?
Yes.
So sometime in the summer of 23, you're again contacted and asked to do a evaluation regarding conditional release?
Yes.
And what did you do regarding that?
Are you asking for my methodology?
Sure.
I'm now going to refresh my memory for my report with the court's permission.
Which you may do.
For the 2023 evaluation, I met with Ms. Geyser for an hour and a half in-person interview at the Winnebago Mental Health Institute. I reviewed the criminal complaint. I reviewed her records with the Winnebago Mental Health Institute with emphasis on those that had accrued in the interim between the 2022 and 2023 evaluation. I also reviewed a 16-page, at that time, Wellness Recovery Action Plan, which Ms. Geyser provided me with a copy of that she had developed. I reviewed her records with our office. I reviewed her records with the Wisconsin Forensic Unit. I also, on July 25th of 2023, had a brief collateral telephone contact with her treating psychiatrist, former treating psychiatrist at that time.
Did you, as part of that report, make your own diagnosis of what her mental state was at that time?
Yes.
And what was your diagnosis on the August of 23 report?
Again, refreshing my memory from my report. Post-traumatic stress disorder, social anxiety disorder, and unspecified schizophrenia spectrum and other psychotic disorder.
Do you know why there was still a diagnosis of unspecified schizophrenia disorder at that time?
At that time, I flagged it history of that condition because I think and still believe that it's important in terms of her diagnostic formulation to acknowledge that for most of the time, since her NGI acquittal in this case, she's been identified with a psychotic spectrum disorder and treated for the same.
Well, did you believe that she still carried that diagnosis at that time? Or was it just that there was a history of it?
I was certain that there was a history of it. I acknowledged in my report the diagnostic conundrum that had been presented by this case in the interim between the 2022 evaluation and present.
And what is that conundrum that was presented?
The conundrum occurred in the fall of 2022 when Ms. Geyser told her treating psychiatrist that she had never heretofore suffered from psychotic symptoms, but rather that she was faking those or mimicking those from others in order to, and that she had begun to do that immediately following the offense in this case, the index offense, and that she had done that to assure that the home in which she was sexually abused by her father repeatedly was one to which she would not be returned, and that she would stay in a mental health institute.
What did you think when you were presented with that information of her indicating she had never experienced psychotic symptoms?
What I acknowledged in my report, again, is that diagnostic conundrum. What I also knew is that in the wake of disclosing that she had never suffered psychotic symptoms or her perspective in 2022, she underwent a significant treatment change. Withdrawn from her treatment was an antipsychotic medication. And in the wake of that medication change, so in the fall of late 2022, through the time I met with her, she had exhibited no objectively noted recurrence of psychotic symptoms.
And did you have concerns regarding her presentation or her indicating that she had never suffered from psychotic symptoms?
Yes.
What was your concern?
My concern is the accuracy of that perspective that she offered in 2022 to her treating psychiatrist and why she offered it. Because the overwhelming amount of medical records that were accrued for the many years preceding that pointed in the direction of bona fide psychotic symptoms that Ms. Geyser was experiencing.
And why is the accuracy of her self-reporting important?
Because psychotic symptoms are essentially a private phenomenon. The rest of us don't hear the voices if someone's hearing them. The rest of us don't hold the delusional beliefs someone holds. And they're not tangible. And so one source of information necessarily or ideally is the person experiencing those symptoms himself or herself or themselves.
Is it fair to say that in considering whether or not she's suitable for release, you also have to have some ability to trust her self-reporting?
Yes.
Why?
Again, because psychotic symptoms are private phenomenon, in part. And so for Ms. Geyser, psychotic symptoms elevated her risk for violence. So certainly one would want to know if those in fact exist, despite what is or isn't observable by others. Because you're appraising, essentially, her risk for future violence.
Was she offering any explanation, either to you or in any of the records you reviewed at that time, why this underlying offense occurred?
She has maintained that it had to do with the delusional, my word, delusional, or characterization of imperative of becoming a proxy for Slender Man and avoiding her family and her co-defendant's family from being killed.
But wasn't she now claiming that none of that was true, that she didn't really believe that at the time the offense occurred?
No, it's not that she said she didn't believe that. It's that she said that wasn't accompanied by psychotic symptoms. She described it more like a fantasiful belief of a 12-year-old who had been from an abusive family.
You ultimately concluded in regards to that August of 23 report that she was still not suitable for release, correct?
Correct.
Why did you believe that at that time?
Leading up to that evaluation, she continued to struggle with pretty prominent symptoms of anxiety and trauma-related symptoms that were concerning despite the apparent absence of psychotic symptoms. It had also been relatively recent that she had made that serious suicide attempt in 2021. Additionally, concerning at that time was whether she could sustain her level of functioning in the long term, given the recency of the medication change and the history of this case and the lengthy history of the symptoms that she had labored under.
Let's talk a little bit about that suicide attempt in 2021. How did you become aware of that?
Both from Ms. Geyser and from the record.
And so you actually talked to Ms. Geyser about it?
Yes.
And what was discussed between you and Ms. Geyser about it?
What she told me is that she had attempted suicide by placing a cord about her neck. She had been given some instruction or tips on how to do it, so to speak, from another patient. She made the suicide attempt at night when her roommate was asleep, and it was quite serious. As I recall, she told me that she had broken blood vessels in her eyes, for example. She had exited her room, and staff immediately intervened after she attempted suicide.
Was her exiting of her room to try to get help because she couldn't free herself from the cord she had put around her neck?
I believe so.
And staff ultimately had to cut that cord to free it?
I believe so, yes.
And there was some significant injury as a result?
Yes, it's described in the record, and in fact by Ms. Geyser herself, as a serious attempt.
At least between the offense on May 31st of 2014, there had been no attempt to harm anyone until this attempt to harm herself. Is that right?
Not precisely.
Why is that?
There had been other attempts at self-injurious behavior, not suicide, but self-injurious behavior. So previously at the age of 18 or 19, for example, Ms. Geyser had swallowed batteries, for example. I believe she was also known on occasion to scratch or cut. Not serious suicide attempts, but those were other acts of self-injury.
And I think I was a little confused in reading the reports. Maybe you can clear this up. Was there multiple occasions of swallowing batteries or just one?
To my recollection, there was only one.
Okay. You did conclude in that August of 23 report that Ms. Geyser did still present a significant risk of harm to herself or someone else. Is that right?
Yes.
And that was the reason you were not in favor of release at that time?
Yes.
And again, after you had authored that report, the request for release was withdrawn?
Yes.
You did indicate some things in that report that you felt you would need to see in order to be supportive of release, didn't you?
Yes.
What were those things?
As I recalled, it was additional sustained psychiatric stability, so a lack of a lack of recurrence of psychotic symptoms, so a longer period of time when she had sustained that level of functioning. Ideally, that she would be provided more opportunities to exercise the liberty, freedoms that she had, including going into the community. So having experiences which would more closely approximate those she might encounter on conditional release. And then I believe I encouraged additionally more structured activities, employment, for example.
And you addressed that in several points in different reports about Ms. Geyser maybe does not take advantage of as much employment opportunity as she could. Is that right?
Yes.
Can you explain that to the court?
Well, most recently, she only resumed employment and then 1 hour a week in early 2024. And she said she was told me she wasn't interested in supported employment in the institution, and that she wasn't interested because it just didn't align with her interests and because of some conflicts that she'd had previously. So, for example, she worked in the library and was evidently falsely accused about having a phone by her supervisor and became quite upset, for example. So she's largely out of personal preference, for whatever reason, has not pursued and sustained employment in the institution.
I'm assuming you still think that that's an issue now as part of your conclusion that she not be released.
Yes, I believe it's an issue because of the questions it raises about her readiness and ability to pursue employment in the ways that she says she wants to if she gets granted conditional release. So it goes to the issue of the realistic nature or not of her plans on conditional release.
And at least you believed that you needed to see more of that back in August of 23 and still believe that now in April of 24, right?
Yes, among other considerations highlighted right in my report.
So you author that report in August of 23 and you're then contacted roughly sometime in March of 24 to do another evaluation, correct?
Correct. I believe it was late January or early February.
Okay. But in any event, you have done two reports in about within seven months of each other. Is that right?
Yes.
And your conclusion now in your the exact date, March 5th of 24 report, is the same, that you don't believe Ms. Geyser yet is ready to be released. Is that true?
On that count, yes, my opinion is the same. I believe I framed it slightly differently in the context of the current evaluation because of the bona fide progress, by all accounts, Ms. Geyser is making toward readiness for conditional release.
Well, tell us, how is it framed in your March 5th of 24 report?
It's framed so that clearly I offer the opinion that as of the writing of my report, it's my opinion to a reasonable degree of professional certainty that the facts weighed contrary to her petition, to her safe release to the community. I also acknowledged the belief, forecasted, if you will, that assuming Ms. Geyser continues her current trajectory in treatment, maintains her psychiatric stability, and to develop coping skills, stress tolerance, and her support system in the community, her readiness for conditional release in the coming months will follow.
How do you assess her support system that might be available in the community currently?
Part of it's by what she tells me, and to the extent I can, to determine whether that's corroborated in the medical records or other sources of information.
I know there was some indication in your current report of some reunification with her mom and her brother. Is that true?
I would say reconnection. So she's established a reconnection with them. I don't want to overstate that because I don't know the frequency, the substance of it, but she has reestablished some connection, whereas previously she was estranged for whatever reason from them.
Would it be fair to say that it's too early to assess how much support her mother would be able to provide if she were to be released?
From the information I have, yes. Both how much she would be able to provide, but also how much Ms. Geyser is willing to receive if her mother is willing to provide it.
I know there's some indication throughout what type of relationship is she able to have with someone while she's at the institution?
She can certainly receive visits of some nature, and she can certainly have telephone contact. So relationships mediated through those types of methods, if you will.
Do you know, and I correct me if I'm wrong, I think there was some mention of a relationship with a 63-year-old man?
I believe so.
And do you know the nature of that, whether it was by letters or in person, phone contact?
I believe it was at least phone and letters. Whether or not there were any direct visits, I don't recall.
And I think there was another similar type relationship with someone in their early 40s, if I recall.
I believe so.
Again, similar, where this would be letters or phone contact or...
To the best of my knowledge.
I mean, there's not really any ability to have any alone time for her with anyone she may have developed a relationship with, is there?
Strictly speaking, no, I don't believe so.
In the most recent report that you've done, is there also a, and I forget the acronym, but the release plan that she provided for you?
The recovery plan that she provided, yes.
And she talks about some potential future employment or what she'd like to do. Is that right?
Yes, I'm not sure the detail that she went into in that document about that, but that was certainly a topic that we discussed.
Okay, and what did she indicate about that?
She indicated that she had investigated the training and cost associated with it for becoming a certified nursing assistant. I believe she had looked at a program in South Milwaukee or at the south side of Milwaukee. I think she estimated it was $850 and that was something that she might want to pursue. In other contexts, she's talked about possibly wanting to work in a hospital setting, so as a certified nursing assistant. She also, however, talked about wanting long-term to become a writer, and that's been a goal of hers for years. Additionally, she talked about the possibility that she might perform part-time janitorial work, which would not bring her into contact with people but might be able to occur after hours, if you will. It's something that as a child years ago, she actually accompanied her father, and he would perform janitorial work.
Was there something different in the summer of 23 that she was considering as far as employment, if released?
I don't recall.
Okay. Now, most recently, Doctor, with your current evaluation, is there a diagnosis that you attribute to Ms. Geyser?
Yes.
And what is that?
Again, I acknowledged her history of a diagnosis of schizophrenia, unspecified schizophrenia spectrum and other psychotic disorder. I also identified her with diagnoses of post-traumatic stress disorder and social anxiety disorder.
Show you, Doctor, what's marked as Exhibit 2, just so you can tell us what that is.
It's a 34-page report over my signature, memorializing and dated March 5th, 2024, memorializing the evaluation findings that I reached in this case, and it's accompanied by a cover sheet.
I believe that
In this most recent evaluation, Doctor, there was also a change regarding Morgan's reporting related to anxiety symptoms?
Yes.
Can you talk about that, please?
Earlier this year, so in January, February, Ms. Geyser underwent an institution-based risk assessment to determine her appropriateness to continue receiving the level of privilege that she receives in the institution and possibly to be granted more. In the context of that evaluation, the best that I could tell from the records, Ms. Geyser disclosed that she had also not truly experienced anxiety symptoms, but rather had said that she did so that she could avoid group therapy.
How do you assess that?
Ultimately, I'm not sure what to make of it. That may, for example, one of the hypotheses that I considered was that Ms. Geyser was possibly saying that so that her diagnoses could be altered, so that the anxiety disorder diagnosis might come off of her formulation, for example. At the very least, what it called into question is her recent reliability as a historian and reporter of her symptoms, and that was what was concerning to me. So the jury's still out, if you will. We're not sure what that means, why she said that.
And again, is it fair to say that the reliability of her reporting is very important to you in trying to determine level of risk that she presents?
Yes, and I would add that she's largely a remarkably reliable informant. So the information she provided me about her history, for example, in the interim between the two evaluations, was mirrored in the record. But about that potential for anxiety symptoms or historic psychotic symptoms, that's the one area she's not been. Reports she hasn't been a reliable reporter.
That institution-based risk assessment also included some statements that you found concerning, and I'm talking about October 24th of 2023. Do you remember that?
Yes.
And what was concerning about some statements she made during that assessment?
What was concerning was the content of them and the topic that they referenced.
And please explain that.
Perhaps it's best if I quote the record.
Please.
So the comment she made during an individual therapy session, kind of an emotion-charged individual therapy session in which Ms. Geyser has invested herself. So she's done a lot of work in individual therapy. But the comments that were memorialized in the clinical notes from the session on October 24th included, quote, "How do you think I was able to repeatedly stab my best friend and bitch face," referring to the co-defendant, "thought she was all the brains. I was pulling her along too. I didn't care. I couldn't care. I've never known how to care." End of quote.
That's something that stood out to you in your review of the records, true?
It stood out. I wasn't sure how to put context to it. So I knew, for example, that that had been said. I acknowledged in my report that that could have been merely emotion-charged comments made in the face or in the context of therapy, which sometimes happens, for anyone who's been in therapy would know. On the other hand, this is quite recent to petitioning for conditional release and suggests, at least in that moment, a callous perception of herself. She later talked with her therapist about that and put that in terms of a question. So she reframed it and said, how could I have cared if I did this to my best friend? But the recency of it relative to her petition for conditional release, the reference to her co-defendant, and to herself, that was a potential red flag, at least for me.
Enough to give you pause as to whether or not she's appropriate to be released at this point?
Enough when taken in the context of the totality of information in this case, not just in isolation.
Because you indicate in your report that at this time, her release is a challenging call, right?
Appraising her readiness for conditional release is a challenging call, yes.
Why is it a challenging call?
Because of the multiple and several complex case characteristics and the fact that Ms. Geyser is now approaching 22 years of age and she spent virtually all of her adolescence and much of her young adulthood in an institution. In some cases, in most cases, I would say when I'm conducting a conditional release evaluation, I have a baseline for the individual of how they've functioned in the community as an adult. We don't have that in this case. All we know is how Ms. Geyser functioned prior to the age of 12 in the context of what appears to have been certainly dysfunctional, but also an abusive childhood.
And although all of this, as you indicate at this point, presents a challenging call, your call, at least to a reasonable degree of professional certainty, is that she still presents a significant risk of harm to herself or others and is not at this time appropriate for release?
Yes.
Is there anything else, Doctor, that you think the court should know in deciding what to do in this situation?
On balance, I believe my report has captured the salient points at this juncture.
I don't have anything else, Judge.
Thank you. Cross-examination.
Good afternoon, Dr. Collins.
Good afternoon.
Let's start by going back to 2014 when we brought you on board, right? It was the defense, myself, my firm that brought you on board, right?
Yes.
And there were some things that were missed back then, one of which would be the sexual abuse that Morgan was suffering from. Would you agree with that?
I would say it was missed, but not because it wasn't looked for, not because it wasn't, Ms. Geyser wasn't queried about it multiple times, at least by myself.
She was 12 years old at the outset of this case?
Barely, yes.
An 11-year-old who had just turned 12 when this happened?
Yes.
And now Morgan is at a point where she has spoken more freely about the sexual abuse she was subjected to?
Yes.
Tell the court a little bit about that abuse. What is she reported?
She reports that the sexual abuse, was perpetrated by her father, and that it goes back, or it started as early as she was forming memories. She reports that she tried to tell or communicate that to her mother, that there were red flags, but those weren't heeded. She recalled, for example, during one interview with me, that she would resort to sleeping on the floor because she knew her father couldn't get down to the floor and back up. Ostensibly, she said she did it to be near her guinea pigs or pets, but it was really to avoid the sexual abuse. She reports that her father watched her shower. She reports that her father was often, she knows now, under the influence of drugs and alcohol.
Right, and her mother was where?
Often at work.
Not in the home to protect her.
Correct. And compounding it is that when Ms. Geyser told her mother did not either heed what Ms. Geyser told her mother or believe her.
So Morgan, when she would report these things within the home, her mom would not believe the things she was saying about her dad?
To the extent Morgan was able to report it, correct.
Now, after this crime happened, there was diagnoses that you rendered with respect to Ms. Geyser, that now things are different 10 years later. Is that a correct statement of things?
Certainly, she's now received different diagnoses than she did during the history or pendency of this case and in the years after.
And I think you were asked this by Mr. Sapakowicz, but with respect to a child at the age of 12 years old, you yourself, as an experienced doctor, you're trying to assess the mental functioning of a 12-year-old. That was sort of your task back then, right?
Correct.
And I don't want to put words in your mouth, but as part of that task, you're looking at the professional literature, the DSM, and things like that, right?
Correct. There was a wealth of records, the collateral interviews with her parents, meeting with her, psychological testing.
Right. And I guess I just want to drill down into this because I'm not clear on, when we have diagnoses like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, the diagnoses we see in the DSM, is this validated with respect to 12-year-olds or 11-year-olds?
Well, for example, bipolar disorder isn't a condition that we would place on a 12-year-old.
Let's just use the schizophrenia because that was a diagnosis. Is the DSM validated that this has been assessed on 12-year-olds?
The DSM does contain diagnoses that can be applied to individuals across the lifespan.
Okay. But isn't there a particular problem with children assessing what might be a vivid imagination, a child as they're 11, 12 years old versus auditory and visual hallucinations? Isn't it difficult to really diagnose and assess what's going on in the head?
Yes, it's difficult to conduct mental health evaluations with adolescents or 12-year-olds or children because you're trying to identify and define a moving target.
Right, the child's brain is developing.
Yes.
And a 10-year-old, maybe the
9-year-old. Excuse me, I'm just going to interrupt you. I've got this tickle in my throat.
I wasn't sure if I should stop or not. I don't want to.
It was good because everybody's missing it. Just going to take about a 5-minute recess.
Okay, great.
And doctor, you can step down.
Thank you. All rise.
Thank you. Please be seated. We'll be back on the record then. Thank you. You may continue now with your comments.
Thank you, Judge. When we left off, Doctor, I was just trying to understand. I hope my question was somewhat understandable, but you, back then, 2014, you're dealing with Morgan as a 12-year-old girl, right?
Yes.
With, you know, 12-year-olds have an imagination, they have an undeveloped brain. Would you agree with that?
I'd say they have a developing brain, yes.
Yeah, I shouldn't say undeveloped, developing brain. Doesn't the psychiatric literature recognize that it's difficult to diagnose psychotic spectrum disorder with children because of the vivid imaginations and developing brains that they have?
Among other reasons, yes.
Okay. And that could be part of the problem here then, right? That Morgan had a vivid imagination, a developing brain, but now she's much more mature as a young woman in her early 20s.
Yes.
Now, this is the third report you've done, and it sounds like it's a long report, and you've reviewed a lot of records. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
And really what we're trying to figure out here, what you're trying to offer an opinion on, is, and you use the phrase, when it's granted, eventually you predict that release should be granted, will Morgan be safe in the community? That's essentially what this comes down to, doesn't it?
Yes, whether she would pose a significant risk.
And, right. And when the court grants that petition, whenever that is, if it's tomorrow, if it's 6 months from now, but when the court grants that petition, does Morgan simply get, do they just open the doors of Winnebago Mental Hospital and let her walk out into the community?
No.
What do they do?
It's my understanding, in general, that when an individual's petition is granted by the court, then the Department of Health Services, in coordination with their community-based contracted provider, has 60 days to develop a conditional release plan.
Okay, so once the court has issued the green light, let's say, then Morgan goes back to Winnebago. She goes back to the mental hospital, right?
Yes.
And once she's back there, then a plan is developed over the next 60 days and presented to the judge.
Correct.
And you called it a what type of plan?
Conditional release plan.
What does that involve? What does that consist of?
That consists in general in enumerating the conditions under which someone is being released, the rules that they have to abide by or agree to abide by on conditional release, provides for provisions of place of residence, level of supervision, psychiatric treatment, other mental health treatment, other types of treatment that the individual may need.
Okay, and that plan goes back to Judge Boren or the judge who's overseeing the case?
Yes.
And then that plan either gets approved or modified or rejected?
Yes.
Okay. Meanwhile, while that plan is being developed, in any future hearings related to that plan, Morgan still remains in the hospital at Winnebago, right?
Yes.
A place of which she has achieved, of which she has achieved maximum privileges.
Yes.
And would you agree with me, not only has she achieved maximum privileges, but there's nothing else she can do at that facility to have any more opportunity to be released into the community or walk around the grounds or anything like that, right?
I would say there are other ways that she can invest herself in treatment, yes.
Okay. So they could keep working on other treatment things while she's there, right?
And she could invest herself in those too and keep investing herself as she has.
Okay. Now, you've talked about the previous conditional release reports you've done, one in 2022, one in 2023, so I want to walk through a little bit of those, okay?
Yes.
So, in 2022, one of the concerns back then, almost 2 years ago, was that there had been a suicide attempt, and you've talked about that, right?
Yes.
But then, after the suicide attempt, you noted in your report that Morgan's engagement with treatment improved. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
And that she remained compliant with all medication requirements?
Yes.
And that her acting out diminished?
Yes. I may have used language like it wasn't entirely extinguished, but it was certainly diminished, reduced.
And in fact, even back then, in that report, you said, Morgan is not ready now, but she will be with continued progress at the facility. Didn't you say that?
Yes. I anticipated that continuing her current trajectory at that time, that her readiness for conditional release would follow.
Your exact words were, assuming she continues her current trajectory. I want to stop there. Current trajectory meaning no suicide attempts, no acting out, no violent behavior, right?
Yes, an investment in treatment.
Yep.
Clients with treatment.
Right. The trajectory she was on, assuming she continues that trajectory, actively participating in treatment, her conditional release readiness will follow, right?
Yes.
And as you know, we didn't come to court and seek release at that time. Morgan chose to withdraw her petition. You understand that, right?
Yes.
And then fast forward to August of 2023, a year later, you author another report, right?
Yes.
What's significant at this time in August of 2023, doctor, is that Morgan is now in the pre-integration unit at Winnebago. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
What is the pre-integration unit?
Of the four levels, and by moving through those levels, an individual has the opportunity to gain more and more privileges and liberty, responsibility. So she was at the highest or least restrictive and had the opportunity to have the most privileges at that level.
Morgan, when she's at Winnebago, is assessed on an almost constant basis throughout her time there, isn't she?
Yes.
She's observed by staff, by doctors, by social workers, by her integration team. There's a variety of people who are observing her behavior, right?
Yes.
And when you talk about four units, what you're referring to is highly restrictive, least restrictive unit, all the way to the one where they give them the most privileges.
I would say, in the context of pre-integration phase, I'm talking about levels on her unit where she's remained. So it's levels of liberty.
Okay. So within a pre-integration phase, pre-integration meaning they're trying to get somebody ready to integrate into the community, right?
Yes.
Morgan, almost a year ago, August of 2023, she's at the highest rung of the ladder, so to speak, in terms of privileges she gets.
She's at least at the highest of those four rungs. She hadn't yet received the highest level of privilege within the pre-integration phase.
And one thing that was significant that you noted, Dr. Collins, was that at that point, Morgan had underwent or participated in 6 supervised outings from the facility.
Yes.
What are supervised outings?
Supervised outings are when an individual who has this level or this privilege is accompanied by staff and has outings into the community, perhaps to go to a cafe, for example, or a store and to go shopping, or a restaurant, or a library. So they get experience and exposure in the community.
You noted in your report that Ms. Geyser had outings to a library, cafe, restaurant, thrift store, dollar store. Does that sound right?
Yes.
And you said 6 or 7 supervised outings, right?
Yes, that's what the record, the best information I had from the record and her.
Right, because Morgan also corroborates that.
Yes.
And she can narrate what those experiences were like and recall them, right?
Yes.
And there were no problems whatsoever during those outings, right?
Correct.
So Morgan is leaving the facility, she's going out into the community, she spends time at a cafe, she eats a meal at a restaurant, she goes shopping at some stores, no problems.
Correct.
The reason Winnebago does that is because it's sort of twofold, correct me if I'm wrong, but one is to give the person some release opportunities so they can have some semblance of normalcy, and another would be to be able to assess their behavior in that sort of semi-structured environment.
Yes.
And certainly there's people who act out and the facility realizes right away this is a bad idea, this person can't handle their newfound freedom.
Yes, I have seen that happen, not personally, but through records and evaluations that I've done.
And then there's other people like Ms. Geyser who they're just essentially perfect, there's no problem, and they continue receiving those privileges.
Correct.
Now, a very significant point back then, would you agree, was that Morgan's anti-psychotic medication that she had been prescribed for so many years had actually been discontinued a year prior.
Approximately. I think it was 10 months or so, yes.
So in 2022, maybe the end of 2022, the anti-psychotic medication was discontinued entirely.
Yes.
You are a forensic psychologist.
Yes.
You have had the opportunity to study the literature and personally assess any number, hundreds if not thousands of people with psychotic symptoms.
Yes.
Would you agree with me that people who are genuinely psychotic, psychotic condition, that when those meds are discontinued, you see a recurrence of symptoms and a digression in their behavior?
Perhaps not immediately, but if someone has a psychotic spectrum disorder, schizophrenia, for example,
right,
then those symptoms wax and wane, but yes, one would expect a recurrence of those. Of course, you can't predict when.
Right, but it would be very unusual 2 years later to not have seen a recurrence of some symptoms.
Certainly, it's at least atypical.
Right. Have you ever seen that before, where somebody who is actively psychotic, they remove the medication, and 2 years later, they're still doing fine?
I don't recall.
But in any event, it was significant enough that you noted in your report that Morgan was discontinued from the antipsychotic medication, and that was a decision made by the treating doctors at Winnebago.
Her treating psychiatrist, yes.
Or her treating, Dr. Pope, her treating psychiatrist at the time.
Yes.
Now, nothing happens in the facility in terms of medication decisions without the input of doctors and medical professionals, because it's a medical institution, right?
A psychiatric institution, yes, as
right,
compared to a medical hospital.
Provides mental health services.
Yes.
And when the doctors, do you know in this case whether Dr. Pope, through her work with Morgan, simply made that recommendation of, it's my opinion as the doctor, we should discontinue this? Or was it Morgan expressing a desire to discontinue the medication, or do you not know?
I believe it was a collaboration with Morgan.
Okay. And it was done in a way where the medication is discontinued, but the doctors and the professionals will still keep an eye on Morgan or Ms. Geyser to make sure there's no recurrence of any concerning behavior or symptoms, right?
Correct.
If a person genuinely hears voices and they're motivated by auditory hallucinations, the doctors at Winnebago know how to look for that and look for the signs of that, right?
Yes.
They're trained. These are highly trained doctors that deal with these types of cases on a daily basis, right?
Yes.
Most of the people, if not all of the people at Winnebago, have at some point been diagnosed with a serious mental health condition.
The patients, yes.
Thank you for that clarification. And you noted, doctor, that in the wake of the medication changes, Ms. Geyser demonstrated no recurrence in signs of psychotic symptoms. Didn't you observe that or note that?
Yes.
Now, back then, August of 2023, you weren't quite ready to support release. Agreed?
I was not ready. I was did not believe the facts supported her release.
One thing you noted is that there were, as you described it, not enough opportunities for Ms. Geyser to demonstrate her ability to safely manage stressors, liberty, and responsibilities, right?
Yes.
Can we distill that down to just essentially saying you wanted to see more time lapse without problems developing?
Yes, among other things I noted in my report.
Well, one thing you did note was that Ms. Geyser is, these are your words, that Ms. Geyser is notably closer to readiness for conditional release than previously.
Yes.
Notably closer.
Yes.
And when you say than previously, are you referring to the report you drafted in 2022?
Yes.
And prior to her release, you wanted to see numerous opportunities for community outings, part-time employment, and you also wanted to see Morgan organizing her time with pro-social activities, right?
Yes.
I want to talk or ask you briefly about Ms. Geyser's current clinical presentation. Obviously, here in court, she's in shackles, but when you see her at Winnebago, she doesn't look like she looks right now, does she?
No.
How would you describe her appearance to you when you visited with her?
Put together. She wore a coordinated outfit. She was ready for the occasion of the evaluation. I subsequently learned that she had met with two examiners on the same day, but she arrived prepared.
Okay.
So she came with her recovery plan, for example, a copy of that. She had obviously prepared to meet with me.
And would you describe her as engaged in your interview?
Yes.
Did Morgan disdain, or I'm sorry, did she disclaim psychotic symptoms at that time?
She disclaimed a history of frank, you mean to me in the moments of the interview?
Yeah.
Yes.
And that's consistent with what the professionals at Winnebago decided when they made a decision to discontinue the psychotropic medication, right?
I would say it's consistent with the observations of Morgan that, of Ms. Geyser, excuse me, that had accrued in and around the time I met with her. So there was a consistency between what was said in the record and how she presented.
Okay. Now, when you're interviewing her in 2024, right? You're interviewing her this year.
February 13th.
So now, since late 2022, as far as you can tell from the records, Ms. Geyser has not had her psychotropic medication going back to the end of 2022, right?
She's not had antipsychotic medication prescribed to her.
She takes medication for anxiety for her anxiety conditions.
Yes.
So people who start to manifest dangerous symptoms when their psychotropic medication is discontinued, the doctors at Winnebago, they can apply for court orders or seek a medication order or forcibly medicate people, right?
Depending on the circumstances, yes.
And you would agree with me that it's not just that Morgan disclaims the psychotic symptoms, it's that all of the doctors that are treating her must necessarily agree with that because nobody is forcing her to take any antipsychotic medication, right?
I would say I know that they don't perceive her as actively psychotic now because it's not noted in her psychiatry records, for example. She's noted as not exhibiting or endorsing psychotic symptoms.
And in fact, there's a consensus. Isn't there a consensus across all the doctors that Morgan is not a diagnosis of a schizophrenic diagnosis, right? That's not the current diagnosis for her.
Correct.
By any doctor.
By her treatment team, her treating diagnoses do not include a psychotic spectrum disorder at this time.
And anti-anxiety medication, the state asked you about anxiety. Anxiety is where a person just has nervousness, right? Isn't that what anxiety is? A person just feels nervous about things?
Well, that's one form that anxiety can take. It can also take others, panic attacks, for example.
Okay, so Morgan takes these medications as required, as prescribed?
Yes.
To help with, what is her anxiety condition? Do you know is it panic attacks or is it just she has stress or what does she suffer from?
As I recall from the recent informational letter to the court, the two anxiety conditions she was identified with or that they listed as her treating diagnoses are generalized anxiety disorder and social anxiety disorder. Okay. She has other diagnoses.
Generalized anxiety disorder means what?
Just about what it sounds like from the name. Generalized anxiety as compared to anxiety occurring with a particular trigger in mind or in a particular circumstance, like social anxiety disorder.
Okay. Is it possible that the reason she has a generalized anxiety disorder is because she's been committed to a mental institution throughout her adolescence and her early 20s?
I wouldn't attribute the level of anxiety that Ms. Geyser has exhibited merely to her being placed in an institution. Certainly, circumstances in an institution can be very stressful and contribute to anxiety, but I wouldn't blame her psychiatric conditions on the institution that she's placed in.
What would you blame it on?
Probably has multiple sources, if you will, and could be exacerbated by stressful circumstances in the institution.
Like being or being sexually assaulted by your father as a young child?
That can be a contributing factor, yes.
And then finding yourself in a juvenile detention center at 11 or 12 years old?
Yes.
And then obviously spending one's entire teenage years in the mental hospital, Winnebago, would exacerbate it, is what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. So it would seem that one way to reduce the exacerbation of that, and maybe you note this and maybe you the thought of this in your report, would be to work towards release from that institution so that she can go into a less anxiety-producing environment. Fair to say?
Well, I would say you're trading one source of anxiety or one type of anxiety-producing environment for another, because conditional release is surely accompanied by multiple sources of anxiety for someone who spent a decade in an institution. So it's six in one, half dozen in the other.
Sure, but it has to happen at some point. You recognize in your report, you even say she should get out in the near future, don't you?
I frame it a little bit differently from the perspective of a psychologist. So it's my opinion that she is no longer going to meet criteria, that she's going to meet criteria for release in the coming months.
Right, months, not years.
Assuming she continues the direction that she's going and her investment in treatment and any other caveats that I offer in my report, yes.
One thing that was significant that gave you confidence in Morgan's ability to be released is the fact that she has the RAP plan and really has seemed to put a lot of thought into that. Would you agree?
I would say that was one among several factors.
I'll go through some of the others, but the RAP plan itself was very significant because it demonstrates that Morgan herself has really thought hard about what her experiences might look like outside of an institution.
Yes, she's future-oriented, and she's goal-oriented as well.
And goal-oriented in a reasonable way, would you agree?
In the main, yes.
Give or take, depending on the career field. But what I'm saying is, Morgan doesn't come to you and say, my first plan upon release is I want to go run for office and become a president. She doesn't offer some completely detached from reality game plan, right?
Correct.
She says things like, I want to be an author.
Yes.
I want to be a custodian, a janitor.
That part-time work for her might entail that, and that she believed she could do that, that it would be in a circumstance that wouldn't be too stressful, for example.
Right, that's a really good sign that she has thought, well, I might be in a quiet building, it might be after hours, I might have headphones in and I can clean floors and do janitorial work, right?
Yes.
The CNA thing is maybe a little bit more complicated because it might require a financial investment and enrolling in school, but it's not delusional for her to think, well, maybe I could be a CNA and help other people.
It's not delusional, no.
But it's far better than delusional. It's a fairly concrete plan for somebody in this position to have, isn't it?
Yes, it's a concrete plan.
And it's also a realistic plan, something she could do or aspire to do.
Something she could aspire to do.
I suppose whether the facility would hire her becomes what you're probably thinking, the whole other question.
Yes.
Right. But in any event, she doesn't say, I'm going to become a doctor within the first 6 years of getting out of here, right?
Correct.
And Morgan, to her credit, you noted she has 99% group attendance rate.
Yes.
Not a single security hold since August of 2019.
Yes.
And full courtyard liberty, did I note that correctly?
Yes.
And full escorted liberty.
Recently granted, yes.
Did you review, at the beginning of this hearing, I think you were in here, the judge mentioned a February 8th, 2024 risk assessment. Did you review that?
Yes.
Do you remember the contents of it, or do you have it in front of you?
I don't have the document in front of me. There is a summary in my report of it.
Right. And that report is prepared, having done these before, what's the purpose of that report?
The purpose, as I recall, of that report was to appraise whether or not Morgan was appropriate, Ms. Geyser was appropriate to continue at the current privilege level that she had, and it was occurring approximate to her being considered for full escorted liberty in the institution. So whether or not she was safe to do that, if you will, in the institution.
And this report doesn't make a pitch, so to speak, of release or not release, right?
Correct.
It's generally just an overall overarching picture of Ms. Geyser, her diagnoses, and her progress, right?
It's a violence risk assessment.
Now, that report, do you agree with the conclusions of that report that the first diagnosis, or that her diagnoses, are post-traumatic stress disorder, and then the anxiety disorders you mentioned, and then some borderline personality traits?
Yes.
Generally, as a doctor in this field, a psychologist, should we look at this as like order of importance, that probably it's PTSD first with some lesser anxiety condition with some lesser personality trait issues?
That depends on the intent of the individual who listed them.
Okay.
There is history in the field of listing the most sort of the controlling or overarching diagnosis first, but that's not necessarily, doesn't translate into day-to-day notes or a report like this.
Would you yourself agree with that order of prioritizing it in that fashion, that the most pronounced issue, if you will, that Ms. Geyser is dealing with would really be PTSD? Would you agree with that?
Currently, yes.
And PTSD is post-traumatic stress disorder?
Yes.
We sometimes think of that from people who have been through traumatic experiences.
I would say we always think about people who have been in traumatic experiences.
So that's what causes it, is the traumatic experiences that, in other words, PTSD is created, so to speak. A person gets it because they go through traumatic experiences. They're not born with PTSD.
Correct.
Versus other conditions like schizophrenia or perhaps bipolar disorder, a person might just be born with that, right?
Or be vulnerable or predisposed to develop that condition.
Because of some hereditary factors.
Among other factors, yes.
So post-traumatic stress disorder for Morgan, if we're talking about her as an individual, some of that would come from those childhood traumatic experiences that we just discussed earlier, right?
Yes.
But also just growing up in an institutional setting and witnessing people who are actively psychotic and perhaps more dangerous than you, that can create a PTSD condition as well, right?
I would say that can contribute to it and certainly not help the index offense itself also.
Yeah, even the crime, even the juvenile criminal event that happened.
Yes.
Now, as the treating doctors can't fix, obviously things happen to people and they have their experiences and that can't be rectified, but doctors know how to treat PTSD, right? That's a fairly common condition.
Yes, there are treatment protocols and methods for treating PTSD.
Are the medications that Morgan, you talked in your report a little bit about Morgan developing coping skills. Do you remember when you talked about that?
Yes.
Isn't that what somebody like Ms. Geyser is taught, is you handle your PTSD by recognizing the condition first and then developing coping skills to handle it?
That's one approach. That's not, the strictly speaking, the only approach to treating PTSD, but certainly assisting someone in developing coping mechanisms, but also in addressing the symptoms themselves.
And have the symptoms been addressed with Ms. Geyser?
I would say they're in process of being addressed.
Now, that report that we were just talking about, the February 8th report, describes Ms. Geyser as, quote, psychiatrically stable. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
And that she's been that way for quite some time?
Yes.
And that this report describes her as a low risk for violence?
Yes.
And that's based on her behavior?
Based upon everything that went into that evaluation, and her behavior is a part of that.
One thing that was significant was that, you would agree, at Winnebago, for example, there's many people who are much worse, if you will, than Ms. Geyser, people with actively psychotic symptoms who are acting out and acting in a self-injurious or dangerous manner, right?
Yes.
And obviously Ms. Geyser's been exposed to that in whatever way she's been exposed to it, just by nature of being there, right?
Yes.
Now, in January of 2024, there was conflict that Ms. Geyser had with a peer, and your report said that she vented and she was able to work through the conflict. That was something you thought was significant.
Yes.
Why?
Because that goes in the column of an individual's ability to have nonviolent conflict and to control themselves in the face of conflict.
When I look at, and I'm looking, do you have your report in front of you, I assume, right, doctor?
I do.
So I think judge has given you permission to refresh if you need to, but I'm looking specifically at page 29 of your report where you describe Ms. Geyser as calm and respectful. Would you agree?
If you can direct me on page 29 to the paragraph you're referring.
So the middle of the page on page 29, she's, it says by 2/6/24. Do you see that paragraph?
Yes.
In that paragraph, you describe her as psychiatrically stable?
Correct. What I'm doing is describing how Ms. Geyser is characterized by records accrued on that date.
Okay, this is your review of the records that the doctors are creating, right?
Yes.
And let's talk specifically then about the ultimate conclusions. I know the state talked about it, but correct me if I'm wrong, but what you're saying to Judge Boren is you're attempting to look at the statute and what the factors are for the court to consider and make a determination about whether her release today would present a risk of bodily harm or danger to herself or others or property, right?
Yes.
And do you agree with me? That's sort of what the statute talks about, is it almost refers to how do things look today in this moment of in April of 2024, right?
Yes. What do I know now as I'm doing the evaluation?
Okay. And because you've had a long opportunity to work with Ms. Geyser, it seems to me that what's occurring through your reports is an observation that Ms. Geyser has been making sustained progress over the course of three evaluations you've done for conditional release.
Yes, I would say ongoing progress across those evaluations and over time.
And your exact words are, it is this examiner's belief, meaning your belief, Dr. Collins, that Ms. Geyser's readiness for release should follow in the coming months, assuming she maintains her current level of psychiatric stability, continued compliance with and progress in treatment, that she remains free of psychotic symptoms, and that she continues to develop coping skills for managing the anticipated stressors of conditional release, symptoms of anxiety and trauma, right?
Yes.
And You want to see that she continues to actively develop her support system in the interim and improve her stress tolerance, coping skills, and capacity to navigate stressors, right?
Yes.
Because as you note, I think everybody agrees and understands there will be stressors when she's released, right?
Yes.
But that is, would you agree, that's the whole point of a conditional release committee creating, you talked earlier about a 60-day plan that's created. Isn't that the point of that plan?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
That once a court approves somebody for conditional release, there's a whole planning process that goes into it. Didn't you testify to that before?
Yes.
So the team gets together, and Morgan, this is a team that Morgan already has a relationship with, right?
At least a couple of members of that team, yes.
Your report talks about Ms. Geyser having weekly or month, maybe it's monthly contact with one or more members of her release planning team, right?
Yes.
So there's a team that's already been put together that is ready for when the judge approves it, whenever that is, but when the judge gives the green light, that team is ready to work with Morgan to develop the plan to send her into the community, right?
Yes, I believe pieces of that team are in place. I don't know that the whole team has been assembled, for example, because it's still theoretical.
Right, because it hasn't been granted yet.
Correct.
But if it is, if it's granted, and if over the next coming months, call it 2 months, you don't say a number of months in your report, let's call it 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, over that period of time, if Morgan continues on the track she's on and continues doing the things that you describe here, then you would say it's appropriate for her to be in the community, right?
There will be a point when it's my, I anticipate she will be or believe she will be ready for conditional release in the coming months.
Okay. How many months is that, if you had to estimate? Is it 2?
I don't know.
Let's just assume hypothetically the path that you've seen with Morgan, the positive trajectory you've seen, let's just assume it continues exactly as you've seen. Is two more months at Winnebago sufficient?
My best estimate would be 6 to 12 months.
Okay. So you'd like to see some perhaps 6 to 12 month period of time where Morgan is continuing to make this progress, address the things you've mentioned here, and then at that point you would say, okay, there's going to be a plan put in place. She'll be safe in the community. It would be your prediction.
I don't make predictions. I don't know the future. But it's my belief that assuming the things I've delineated in my report, that she will be ready for conditional release in the coming approximately 6 to 12 months.
Thank you. That's all I have.
All right. Thank you. Redirect, Attorney Zepekowitz.
And not until that 6 to 12 month period of time would she not represent a significant risk, correct?
It's my opinion to a reasonable degree of professional certainty that she currently presents a significant risk of bodily harm to herself or others if conditionally released. When pressed to estimate number of months, I would estimate 6 to 12 months. I know she's not ready now.
Nothing else, Judge.
Any further cross?
No.
Doctor, I have a couple questions. What, based upon your review of records and Ms. Geyser, what is her intellectual ability?
We know she has historically a measured full-scale IQ of roughly 129 in the superior range. There have been some other scores that are slightly lower, but well above average, high average to superior range. She's a bright young woman.
With the her historical reporting that she faked a number of assertions that the things she faked had an impact on the diagnoses that she carried. Is that true?
If, in fact, she faked those symptoms.
Well, yeah, right. We're assuming that when she reported faking, that was a true report. But whether they were true or false, her statements that she says were faked had an impact on the diagnoses that she carried up to that time.
Yes.
Is she capable of manipulating and manufacturing circumstances to place herself in a position that's most favorable from her view?
She has that capacity, or that intellectual capacity, But what mitigates that in this circumstance is that she's observed 24 hours a day. So you can't, for example, it's questionable that she would have been able to malinger and pull the wool over the eyes of so many mental health professionals. What's more likely is what she hinted at during the interview with me, in that at the time she was going through this, she may well have been dissociating because of the trauma she was experiencing, and the best labels we could put on it were psychotic symptoms. We know she wasn't well, and the records are replete for years that she wasn't well, and it's incredible to think that she could have faked that well, something she didn't know how to do. She appeared psychotic before she ever arrived to the doorstep of a mental health institution.
On the revelation that she made that she was faking, is there any indication as to why she would now report faking if it wasn't true?
I don't know the answer to that, Judge.
You know, I keep thinking of that statement by Abraham Lincoln. You can fool all of the people some of the time, some of the people all of the time, but not all of the people all of the time. Is this a situation that we're in?
I don't think so.
Well, I have a question regarding your report on page 33. In that middle paragraph that begins, "I recognize," and that's where that quote is in parentheses. "How do you think I was able to repeatedly stab my best friend and bitch-faced co-defendant thought she was all the brains? I was pulling her along too. I didn't care. I can't care. I never known how to care. Three dots," end quote, etc. I guess I'm trying to place that statement in context. How did that develop that she made that revelation or statement to the people she was talking to?
It wasn't people, it was her therapist. So okay. It was in the context of therapy. And that's how it has to be understood. For more context about that, we could go back in my report where I talk about the record review. And one, and I'm on page 27. The second full paragraph.
Let me just get there. I'm there. All right. That's the paragraph that begins in a session?
Yep, on 10/24/23.
All right.
So that's some information about the context of what she and her therapist were talking about and Ms. Geyser's reaction to it. She got upset with her therapist, and that's when this blow-up happened, or blurting out happened. Again, I have to put the caveat that in the context of therapy, one is supposed to talk about difficult things, and things can get emotion charged. So for my purposes, or for my perspective, it was a potential red flag, and I couldn't look away from that when I came down on my opinion that she wasn't ready at this time for conditional release.
All right, thank you. Now, Attorney Zepakowicz, any questions based upon my questions?
No.
Attorney Cotton, any questions?
Yes. I just want to put a fine point on that. You're saying for your purposes, meaning the role you inhabit right now, making a recommendation for conditional release, right?
Yes.
But if we put on another hat, which you were just alluding to, of the therapist hat, that's a good thing, that statement.
It can be a good thing, yes.
It can be a good thing because the point of individual therapy is to people, you said before, people who have been through it understand that what the point of individual therapy is to get people out of their shell, to make those types of raw emotional statements at times, right?
To get to what really matters.
Right.
Yes.
And sometimes you've got to break the shell, and it can become, as you said, emotionally heated and charged.
Yes.
So this is one remark in the context of many years of individual therapy, almost a breakthrough moment with a therapist. Fair?
I don't know whether it was a breakthrough moment with the therapist. It could have been. I don't know.
But of all the records you look at and thousands of pages of medical records, that's the only concerning statement you've been able to identify in all her years of treatment that you pointed out in your report, right?
At least of those records that accrued in the interim between the 2023 three evaluation and present. Okay. That stood out.
Okay, thank you. That's all.
Any questions based on?
Talks about how I didn't care, I've never known how to care. That presents as someone who represents a danger to other people, doesn't it?
Taken in isolation, perhaps, but if you look at follow-up therapy notes from in the paragraph to follow, it appears what Ms. Geyser was saying was her conclusion that she must not have been able to care, because who could care who did this to their best friend, as compared to that she was really claiming to not care.
But that doesn't really explain the comments about being dead inside or having no good or bad feelings relative to anyone or anything. So it would be fair to say that it's hard to know how to take that, correct?
In isolation, yes, it's hard to know. We do know that Ms. Geyser has the capacity to form attachments, can express joy when she has a good visit with a couple of family members that come. So I would say that from the broader perspective, it's unlikely that that reflects a callous fundamental personality structure, for example, for Ms. Geyser. That's just contradicted by other information in the record.
Nothing else.
Nothing.
I have another question. You talked about her level of freedom, if you will, at the institution and how she circulates and gets about. So, but she's not at the top level. What is the next level that she could be at?
I believe she was granted the highest level available just earlier this year. So now she is permitted, when she can use it, through no fault of her own, to share full escorted privileges. You have to share it with the patient. You have to engage in that on grounds with another patient who holds that level. At this time, or at least when I met with her, for Ms. Geyser's purposes, in order to use that, she would have to access someone else who's on another unit with a different schedule, for example. So her opportunity so far to exercise that, to be able at designated times to walk with the other patient without any staff to canteen, for example, has just been limited, partly because she's only been recently granted it, and partly because the patient who shares that level, you have to only share, the rule is, the other patient has to have that same level, is on another unit.
She's been able to access off institution grounds.
Escorted.
Supervised. Does she ever, is a level of supervision available where she can go about off institution grounds unescorted?
I don't believe so. I don't believe that level of privilege exists.
All right, thank you. Any further questions, Attorney Zepekowitz?
No.
Attorney Cotton?
No.
All right. Are you moving into admission in Exhibit 1 and 2?
I would so move, Judge.
Any objections?
No.
Okay, 1 and 2 are received, so ordered. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Have a good day.
You as well.
Is Dr. Collins under subpoena?
No, I think it was simply notified by the court, and I have no problem with her being excused.
All right. Attorney Cotton, any issues? All right, thank you. Do you want to take a brief recess and we call another witness? Or do you want to go ahead?
Sure, we're prepared to continue.
Okay, who is the next witness?
State calls Dr. Lundbaum.
Oh, we just have a 2-minute break on our end, I'm sorry.
Sure, that's fine. Let's take 5 minutes. 2 minutes is hard to function.
Do you want me to come up right away, or should I wait?
No, you can wait. Not unless you have a book to read.
Well, you know.
No, you could stay. Stay down there. That's fine.
I've got lots of things to read always. Nope. So.
All right.
Yes.
Thank you.
please be seated. We're ready to proceed. Then, Attorney Nicolai, you were going to call another witness.
Thank you, Judge. State calls Dr. Lundbaum.
Doctor, if you'd come forward. Then raise your right hand. Clerk will swear you in.
Do you swear that the testimony you're about to give in this matter before the court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
All right, thank you. Then be seated. Microphone is the bar with the red light. Just speak directly into that. Would you state your full name and spell your last name?
My name is Dr. Brooke Lundbaum. First name is spelled B-R-O-O-K-E. Last name is L-U-N-D-B-O-H-M.
M or N?
M, as in Mary.
All right, very good. Thank you. All right, Attorney Nicolai.
Thank you, Judge. Dr. Lundbaum, I'm going to hand you what's been marked as State's Exhibits 3 and 4. And first, looking at Exhibit 3, Doctor, you recognize what that is?
Yes, it is a copy of my CV.
Is that a multiple-page exhibit?
It is. It is currently about 6 pages.
Does that look like a fair and accurate copy of the recent version of your professional resume?
Yes.
I move Exhibit 3 into evidence.
Any objections?
No objection.
Okay, received.
Doctor, could you please explain the degrees that you hold for the court and the schooling that you've had?
So I received a bachelor degree from Hamilton College in 2002 with a concentration in psychology, minoring in sociology. I then went on to do a master's in clinical psychology through the Minnesota School of Professional Psychology, received that in 2006. Through that same school then, I went on to finish up the doctorate in clinical psychology, graduating there in 2008.
And what is your current employment?
I have a couple different roles. So I have a private practice through behavioral consultants. With my private practice, I do a variety of different kinds of psychological evaluations within the court system, both civil and criminal courts, juvenile courts. I also am the clinical director for what we call the Outpatient Competency Restoration Program, or OCRP. That is a statewide program that is sponsored through the Department of Human Services relating to the remediation of adult defendants who have been found not competent to proceed, but who are able to remain within the community. I am the Vice President of Behavioral Consultants.
And in that capacity, do you work with Dr. Collins, who just testified?
I do.
Okay. And in order to perform your duties for all of your areas of employment, have you maintained your license as a psychologist in this state?
Yes.
In terms of the evaluations that you're conducting for the for your private practice, what types of court evaluations are you performing in the criminal context?
So within my private practice, I do an array of things. So conditional release, which is how I became involved in this particular case currently. I have done mental responsibility evaluations, competency examinations for juveniles, evaluations relative to waiver or reverse waiver regarding whether or not a person should stay in juvenile court versus adult court. I have done guardianship evaluations, some civil commitment. There's just an array of different things. I should also mention that I do have some contract work with the Wisconsin Forensic Unit, which is competency examinations for adult defendants.
Okay. How long have you been performing those types of evaluations?
I started with the Wisconsin Forensic Unit and behavioral consultants during my postdoctoral fellowship year. So 2008 to 2009. I was then licensed in 2009, and I've continued to work with those agencies since then in a variety of different capacities.
Specifically in terms of evaluations for appropriateness for conditional release, have you performed many of those evaluations throughout your career?
I have.
And were you asked to perform one of those types of evaluations, in this case involving Morgan Geyser?
I was.
Could you just remind the court how you became involved in Ms. Geyser's case?
So I have been involved in Ms. Geyser's case for now going on 10 years. I initially became involved by doing a court-ordered competency examination within weeks of her arrest for the index offense. I then came back involved later on doing a mental responsibility evaluation relative to her plea of NGI, or not guilty due to mental disease or defect. I also did a evaluation relative to conditional release versus institutional care. That was soon after her adjudication of the NGI plea. I then have also done now three additional conditional release evaluations, one of those with a report not being written due to her decision to withdraw her conditional release petition prior to that being submitted.
For all of those evaluations, did you have an interview with Ms. Geyser?
Yes.
Including this evaluation that we're here for today?
Yes.
Have you ever come to the conclusion that Ms. Geyser is appropriate for conditional release currently?
I have not.
Okay. In terms of other things that you were able to review before forming your opinion today, did you have access to records from Winnebago Mental Health Institute?
Yes.
Did you also consider the underlying index offense?
I did.
Did you consider the violent nature of it?
That isn't part of one factor that I considered amongst the variety of others.
Okay. Ultimately, today, do you have an opinion for Judge Boren in terms of whether Ms. Geyser is appropriate for conditional release?
It is my opinion that she continues to pose a significant risk of bodily harm to self, others, or property. So in other words, I am not in support of her petition for conditional release at this point.
Okay. Throughout your time conducting these evaluations with Ms. Geyser, did you become aware that her self-reported psychiatric symptoms, the nature of the self-report has changed drastically recently?
Within the last couple years, yes.
Does that fact make your job harder in determining appropriateness for conditional release?
It certainly changes things. There was a rather remarkable shift in the conceptualization of her particular mental health diagnoses, as well as the manner with which she describes herself, the index offense, her history of mental health symptoms. There's contradiction in that information, which certainly causes some complexities, I'd say.
In terms of a timeline, would it be fair to say that that shift occurred in November of 2022?
So it appears that it was about summer to fall of 2022. In my interview with her for a conditional release petition in June or July of 2022, there was some beginnings of that shift, although it's not quite like her report in the last two times that I've met with her. By fall, so for sure November or so, there's clear indication in the record of the shift in how she's been self-reporting her mental health issues.
Could you summarize that shift on a timeline for the court?
So since the index offense, so there has been ample information, observations by various mental health professionals, people who have been involved in her care, across settings, across time, that consistently portray her as an individual with flagrant psychotic spectrum symptoms. Things like delusional ideas, auditory and visual hallucinations, tactile hallucinations or related to touch. There have been indications of thought disorganization, bizarre behavior, bizarre comments, and this would be consistent, again, across reporters, across time, across settings that these different observations have taken place. The conceptualization with that has been a schizophrenia spectrum disorder. Beginning in 2012, she began to say that she feigned psychotic spectrum symptoms. There were also, prior to that time, her report of significant mistreatment during her childhood by her father.
You said 2012?
2014,
all right.
I believe is the index fence, sorry. But by that point, the treatment that she was experiencing at Winnebago shifted towards a diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder with her report of feigning psychotic spectrum symptoms. Through those records, there was eventually the discontinuation of a schizophrenia form disorder.
So I just want to make sure that the court is clear on the timeline that we're talking about. So when you, I think that you misspoke and you said that the feigning began in 2012.
Oh.
What year did this shift begin?
So she began reporting that she had been feigning the symptoms in about 2022.
Okay.
And saying that the various observations going even before the index offense were the product of her essentially faking. The data, though, does not support that.
So let's talk about that a little bit more. Can you talk with the court a little bit about how Ms. Geyser's history is more consistent with her actually having had that psychotic mental illness?
Yes. So there is indication in the data, even prior to the index offense, where she was described as eccentric, engaging in odd behaviors. There were at least one time at school where staff had documented concerns that she was observed speaking to herself as if she was responding to stimuli that was not there. That was around the same time that there was an incident which she had brought it's variously described as a mallet or a hammer to the school, that which resulted in her suspension. There was ample information through the discovery materials related to a fixation on Slender Man in part, but also other different kinds of characters or other morbid themes. It was revealed that she had been engaging in odd behaviors, including by her own admission, she was engaging in what she called a medieval torture game. There was some indication that she had disfigured dolls that she had, lots of drawings related to kind of these morbid themes, these different characters. After the offense, immediately during her interview with the officers, she displayed rigid ideas related to that fictional character, Slender Man, and related her behavior to essentially trying to appease him due to belief that she thought that she and her family were in danger. That kind of belief persisted for months, if not at least a couple years, where that was quite rigid, pervasive, even despite the legal issues she was facing, despite numerous contacts with different people challenging the realness of those thoughts.
During the time that Ms. Geyser was suffering from those persistent delusions, was that also a time when she was not legally competent?
Right. So in June of 2014, if I had the year right, so soon after the index offense occurred, I saw her for a competency examination, as did another evaluator. Both of us received information, but also observed Ms. Geyser demonstrating overt or flagrant signs of psychosis, including thought disorganization, fixation on these delusional ideas that have no basis in reality. She was engaging in odd behavior, elevated affect, where she would laugh or be rather excitable in response to serious situations. With me, she demonstrated psychomotor agitation, where she was restless, having a very difficult time sitting still. So the totality of that information at that time led me to provide an opinion that she was not competent to proceed due to the severity of her symptoms.
Talking about the symptoms prior to 2022, early on in this case that you've just described, were those seen both objectively and subjectively in the records?
They were.
Could you explain the difference to the court of what I mean in my question?
Sure. So throughout time, Ms. Geyser would report what she was experiencing. So she would say she was experiencing different kinds of voices where she had named them. Some of the ones that were most prominent were Maggie, Voldy, and Sev, or three that were very prominent and consistent for years that she would talk about. She would outwardly endorse delusional ideas, such as maintaining the belief that she had to engage in the behavior underlying her current case because she was at risk and her family was at risk as a result of Slender Man. By observation, staff at the institution, especially Winnebago, where she was for quite some time, but also through the detention center and when she was receiving treatment through the Waukesha County Department of Human Services, they observed numerous times where she was distractible, she had pressured speech, thought disorganization. They observed times where she would be laughing to herself or talking to herself as if responding to the voices that she had been reporting. So it's not just her self-report, but there were these observations that helped to substantiate that schizophrenia diagnosis.
Okay. Now, I want to ask you about the shift that occurs in 2022. Would you categorize Ms. Geyser's own description of her mental illness as consistent?
Can you rephrase maybe?
That was a terrible question. I'm sorry. In terms of, if I asked you today, does Ms. Geyser believe that she ever suffered from psychotic symptoms?
As of today, in her current report, she has said that she has never experienced psychotic spectrum symptoms.
Has Ms. Geyser also told you things that are inconsistent with that, even as recent as your last evaluation?
I'm not sure if I'm understanding. Her current self-report of essentially denying all history of psychotic spectrum symptoms would not be consistent with the data that exists. So outside of her self-report, it's inconsistent with her past self-report as well. It's a rather marked change in how she has viewed her symptoms, but as well as how those around her, her treatment team, and the evaluators have seen her as well.
In terms of endorsing any type of psychosis that may have been brought in by trauma, has Ms. Geyser discussed anything like that with you?
She has inconsistently discussed that. During our evaluation, both last year in 2023 and the more recent evaluation, she adamantly denied that there was any history of psychotic spectrum symptoms. She insisted that she had faked it all, essentially. However, with additional conversation, she kind of moved a bit to say, well, at least one of her providers have said that maybe she did in fact experience symptoms that could have looked like psychosis as a result of the trauma that she was experiencing at the time, but hadn't necessarily embraced that herself. Rather, her first line of communication about her mental health history is to say, I faked it. I never had these things. which again, to be clear, is not consistent with the data.
Is Does her claiming that create a difficulty in having a true picture of the trajectory of her mental illness?
It does.
Could you explain that, please?
So if one were to accept her current report that she faked it all, that would suggest that she was involved in a very calculated, long-term manipulation of the court principals, mental health staff, her family. It would be her treatment providers there at the institution. That would be rather remarkable. That would be very callous as well. That line of that theory creates concerns about her ability to trust her self-report or her presentation, given that that would have been years of feigning mental illness in such a way that numerous people believed her to have a severe mental illness.
What if the opposite was true? What if there was a true psychosis going on, and now Ms. Geyser is disclaiming that? Does that cause you concerns for potential conditional release?
That also does. So if accepting that she in fact does have a major mental illness and she was experiencing psychotic spectrum symptoms, whether trauma-related or due to a schizophrenia disorder or otherwise, so diagnostic label notwithstanding, her current account of her mental health history of symptoms and problems that she experiences at periods of decline, we have issues with being able to reliably trust her own self-appraisal. One of the things that's important for individuals on conditional release is that they be able to communicate effectively with their treatment team so that appropriate services and supports can be placed around them to ensure that things are going well. And if the person is not able to have insight into their mental health conditions, the potential warning signs of decline, the triggers that could cause decline, have insight into the kinds of treatment that may be beneficial, it raises a lot of concerns about appropriateness to be discharged.
Did you challenge Ms. Geyser on this claim that she has never actually had delusions or hallucinations during your interview on February 13th of this year?
I did.
Did you ask Ms. Geyser about her claims that she intentionally manipulated the court and mental health providers into believing that she was NGI in this case?
I did.
And what was Ms. Geyser's response to that?
Well, there was quite a bit of conversation about that because it is inconsistent with the data. So I did, in fact, confront her with various observations and contradictions that have existed across time, including my own observations. She, throughout all of that, again, was insistent that she had essentially faked it. She had told me that she decided, essentially once reaching the age of adulthood, that she felt safe, that she would never have to go home to her family home, and that's why she essentially decided to come clean. When I had asked her about, well, how could anybody essentially trust her self-report given this claim that she, for the long term and in a very advanced manner apparently, faked mental illness, how could anyone believe her self-report? She essentially told me, well, I guess you can't. In my report, there's an actual quote, but that just was, well, I guess you can't.
So there's an acknowledgement by Ms. Geyser that credibility is a huge problem here.
Correct. There does seem to be a a significant issue with the change in conceptualization and her own way of describing her mental illness that raises significant complications in being able to understand her mental illness in particular, but also being able to understand the trajectory of it, what may result in decline potentially, and how to effectively manage that mental illness. And that's very important given that all indications suggest that her illness was in large part to the index offense, that severe violence, in large part related to the symptoms she was experiencing.
Is planning, safety planning, and thinking about stressors one might encounter on conditional release an important part of an evaluation of whether someone's ready?
It is.
When you asked Ms. Geyser if she thought she might face stressors that could cause her to decompensate, what did she tell you?
She did not believe that she would face stressors that could cause psychiatric decompensation or behavioral decompensation. She, to her credit, was aware that she may face stressors or barriers related to having this index offense on her record and having a level of notoriety because of the high publication of her story.
Does Ms. Geyser think it's possible that she will decompensate into a psychotic state at this point in time?
She denies that, in part because she denies ever experiencing psychotic spectrum symptoms ever in her life.
Does that make Ms. Geyser a danger to the community?
What is very concerning to me is that contradiction of her self-report compared to years worth of data. I mean, thousands upon thousands of pages of mental health records to compare her self-report to. It's inconsistent. It doesn't line up. And so there's a significant concern about the reliability of what she says in her presentation and being able to understand where things actually are within any given moment of time.
Would you say that this change in her self-perceived mental illness has in fact made this case more complicated than if you would have been dealing with a schizophrenic individual undergoing treatment?
In my personal opinion, it does. For me, doing the conditional release evaluation currently, there are a number of different, what I would say, branches that her case now goes off onto that you have to consider of, well, if this is true, then I need to consider these risk factors related to her risk for violence. On the other hand, if this avenue or branch is true, then there are other considerations to make. So being at this stage, with a conditional release evaluation, this level of uncertainty and complexity, in my experience, is a bit atypical. And given the complexities of risk assessment in and of itself, creates a more challenging conceptualization and report.
In cases where you've supported conditional release, was there markedly less complexities in your analysis than this case?
Every case is different. I mean, certainly I've done a number of cases where there are quite a number of complexities, but the marked shift in Ms. Geyser's particular case is striking and does create these extra complexities that lead me to the opinion that she's not currently safe to be discharged to a less restrictive environment under conditional release.
When you kind of were analyzing this shift and completing your report, did you refer back to a psychological assessment that Ms. Geyser underwent in 2022?
That is one of the comprehensive evaluations that I considered, but that is the most recent comprehensive psychological evaluation that's taken place at the institution, and that particular evaluation had a goal in mind of diagnostic clarity to aid in treatment planning, especially because of the shift in the manner with which she's describing her mental health issues.
Is that psychological assessment something that you spoke about in quite a bit of detail in the last report that you wrote for conditional release?
Correct. My summary of that would have been in the August of 2023 report in some detail.
Through that psychological assessment, did Ms. Geyser give any insight into why this shift may have occurred?
Am I able to look at that report?
Sure.
I have it here. Can I use my copy?
Just for the record, so that it's clear, which report are you going to be looking
August at? August 2023?
Yes, okay. That's document 545. I'd ask that she be allowed to refer to that, Judge.
Any objections?
No objection.
All right, very good.
Thank you. I just don't want to misspeak. Okay, so the summary of that particular evaluation starts on page 14, just so everybody's on the same page. But in that evaluation, going on to page 15, that examination, and this is my summary of the report, talks about her claims that she's never experienced any kind of psychosis, and that she fabricated all of the symptoms that were previously observed and well documented through the record. This would be in the second full paragraph, about a quarter of the way down. The examiner described Ms. Geyser as being motivated to participate in that particular evaluation because she wanted to have the schizophrenia label removed. And when discussing why it was important to her to have this particular label removed, the examiner noted that her reasoning wasn't entirely clear, but she discussed that she posited about whether or not she might be released early if she did not have a schizophrenia diagnosis. She also discussed a desire to go off the antipsychotic agent that she had been taking due to some side effects, including weight gain. There was also some indication of whether or not there was discomfort sharing the same diagnosis that her father had had, especially while she had been undergoing treatment specific to her claims of significant sexual abuse by him.
So, am I hearing you correctly that back in November of 2022, during this psychological assessment, Ms. Geyser at least endorsed a thought that not having schizophrenia as a diagnosis would perhaps allow her release sooner?
As documented in that evaluation, it appears to be the case.
I just want to go back to, I have the report in front of me. Where are you referring to, pages 15 and 16?
So the summary of that particular evaluation starts on page 14. The specific comments that I am referring to are found on page 15, beginning in that first full paragraph, and then more so in the second.
With regard to her history, is that how it begins?
Right.
All right, and then in the next paragraph. True?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Mm-hmm.
So at least that evaluator believed that Ms. Geyser had sort of a goal there of deleting schizophrenia from a diagnosis. True?
It appears that that was at least a theory that had been discussed at the time of that particular evaluation.
And since this particular evaluation, has schizophrenia been removed as a diagnosis for Ms. Geyser that she's being treated for now?
So, to be clear, that particular evaluation was for the purpose of diagnosis. That examiner, as is consistent with different conditional release evaluations that have been done, along with all the other evaluations that have taken place over time, went into some detail regarding the symptom history, the observations, essentially ruling out feigning as a possibility, that it just didn't make sense. That examiner noted that she had displayed positive adjustment to not only the medications that she was taking at that time, but historically there was notable benefit to the use of antipsychotic agents. So that examiner did support the ongoing diagnosis of schizophrenia as well as additional diagnoses. But it was in the wake of that evaluation because of Ms. Geyser's, as I understand it, because of Ms. Geyser's account of feigning these psychotic spectrum symptoms, her treatment provider took her off of the antipsychotic agent.
So the clinician that performed this psychological assessment still endorsed the schizophrenia diagnosis?
Yes, and there's certainly complexities to that. In part, the young age in which Ms. Geyser came to the court, came to the mental health system, the severity of the symptoms that she was describing, they were quite severe, quite atypical. You have complication of fantasy being involved. There is indication that she had essentially taken some of these fantasies that she had, and they became enmeshed with the underlying thought disorder related to the psychosis. So those two things kind of blended together. There also is some indication across time of a potential some exaggeration, some immaturity related to her self-report. So it's not a, what I would say, textbook, a textbook case to diagnose. And it's inherently difficult with adolescents because we don't typically see schizophrenia begin at such a young age as what Ms. Geyser had reported.
Does it appear to you through your review of records and your interviews with Ms. Geyser that she is able or she does report things in a way that results in desirable outcomes or things she thinks will result in desirable outcomes?
I would say most people do that. So certainly I would say Ms. Geyser does that as well.
Ultimately, the antipsychotic medications were discontinued with Ms. Geyser, right?
Correct.
And to date, she has not self-reported psychiatric symptoms since their discontinuation.
She has reported a variety of psychiatric symptoms, but not flagrant psychotic spectrum symptoms. To be clear, there's a variety of other issues that she does freely self-report and are abundantly evident through the records, but those flagrant psychotic spectrum symptoms like auditory hallucinations, delusions, she has described them as imaginary friends. That, while it was once prominent in the records, is not reflected really since around that, well, even before that time a bit, but it's been quite some time since she's reported those flagrant psychotic spectrum symptoms.
Are there incidents of Ms. Geyser exhibiting symptoms that you believe are consistent with symptoms she was exhibiting during psychosis at a young age?
In review of the daily reports, there are a number of atypical behaviors that are documented. It's hard to know whether those might relate to reemergence, more subtle signs of psychosis, or if it is related to dissociation as a result of a post-traumatic stress disorder. But there certainly is evidence of overlap of some of these observations that have occurred more recently at times where she was also known to be more symptomatic, and it was characterized or conceptualized as a psychotic disorder.
Could you give an example for the court?
Sure. So looking back at her treatment records, one of the more subtle signs of her illness, people would describe her as evidencing odd mannerisms or kind of odd body posture. So it might be in terms of her hand movements or how she would walk. In recent months, there were a number of notes by staff indicating that she was doing some odd things, like as walking down the hallway, sticking very closely to the wall and kind of touching the wall as she went. There have been a number of incidents where she has come out of her bedroom in the middle of the night in an apparent, what I would say is consistent with dissociation, but appearing to be quite fearful, essentially not able to verbalize what's happening for quite some time. Once able to verbalize, being very upset, so crying, taking quite a bit of time to calm down and to regroup emotionally.
Are some of those examples what you've summarized in your report from pages 12 through 17?
Yes.
Taking each event that you've indicated, it's true that you did this in chronological order, is that true?
I did, yeah.
And, you know, taking each thing alone, they may seem like insignificant notes, but why did you believe that including this was notable and important for the court?
So, conditional release, we're certainly looking at how a person is doing currently. That's very important. And to be clear, all indications suggest that Ms. Geyser's been doing well at the institution, behaviorally, comparatively with respect to her mental status, that there have been notable gains. That said, when you look at these incidents together, but as well as in comparison to her known mental health history, it becomes much more alarming. So some of these subtle signs of her illness that we've seen in the past continue to be prevalent. A lot of these particular incidents that I note reflect ongoing maladaptive coping skills where she's easily overwhelmed emotionally and is vulnerable to becoming essentially dysregulated, and it takes quite a bit for staff to engage with her, have her effectively identify and utilize those coping skills that she's developed, but she's not doing that independently yet.
Is that a concern that you took into consideration for your opinion today?
It is.
Is there another example of this symptomatic behavior that involves Ms. Geyser's five senses?
So on February 20th, this is coming from page 17 of 30, on February 20th, it was an odd, just kind of one-off notation in the records saying that she didn't enjoy going outside because the sun makes her skin feel weird. And in and of itself, that doesn't really seem to mean much, except for in our interviews across time, she has consistently identified that one of the signs of potential decline for her is that she has kind of hyper senses, like she starts experiencing somatic symptoms. So that, in connection with some of the additional somatic issues that I talk about in this report, while not indicating flagrant psychosis, it is alarming that, at the very least, it suggests that she's not symptom-free at this point.
I would ask if we could look at page 12 of 30 of your report. At the bottom, before you begin that chronological list, is it fair to say that there's several areas of need that you've identified there?
Yes.
And the first being heightened emotionality, is that true?
Yes.
Was that something that Ms. Geyser exhibited in any of those community outings that she participated in?
No, those community outings, by all accounts, those seem to have gone well. She is described as silly at times. She can be a bit hyperactive, but there's nothing to suggest flagrant hyper-emotional response during those particular outings.
What did you observe that that made you opine that that's an area of need for Ms. Geyser?
So being detailed in the next several pages of my report, there's numerous incidents in which she becomes quite tearful in response to intrusive thoughts about her reported past trauma, being overwhelmed by different events taking place on the unit, some more significant than others. Some are rather innocuous, though, becoming completely overwhelmed by, say, a yoga exercise or a topic of conversation in therapy. And there's numerous notes that suggest the need for staff support to regain her composure, to help her to identify and utilize those coping skills that she's been learning about. And to her credit, when in comparison to past years, it's easier for her to regain her composure. And there's not evidence to suggest that flagrant psychosis or delusions, but those incidents still regularly happen, and that's a concern to me.
Did you have concerns about low empathy for Ms. Geyser?
I don't have that concern. In my interactions with Ms. Geyser over the course of the last several years, she has displayed empathy to me. She's demonstrated the ability to make quality relationships with people. So I don't find that to necessarily be a thing, except for that is documented in the records where there's times where she can present with kind of a callous or rude interpersonal demeanor. I think more likely is that she characterizes herself as lacking empathy or being unable to feel at times, which, again, I don't believe that to be the case. Certainly her emotional responses that she's displayed across time would weigh in contrast of her inability to feel. But at various points, she has described herself as lacking the ability for empathy and to care about other people.
In general, does that characteristic make someone less appropriate for conditional release?
Lack of empathy and remorse historically would be a risk factor that we would consider, but to be clear, I don't believe that she possesses that. I see her as an individual who is empathic, who is capable of social bonds. So I personally don't. I have not seen that in her description of her day-to-day functioning just doesn't seem to match that, but she has characterized that, and so it's a recurring theme throughout the records.
Did you, I know that in your report, you took a look at interpersonal relationships that Ms. Geyser has, is that true?
Yes.
And is there's been noted multiple relationships with men who are much, much older than her, true?
Yes.
And have you found that she lacks insight into in potential dangerousness of those kinds of relationships?
This is, what I would say that this is a topic that's difficult because of her circumstances being at the institution for years. So by nature of her placement, she's not had the opportunities that most individuals have as they're growing up to establish developmentally appropriate relationships. By nature of her institutionalization, she's had a number of people in her life that pulled apart from her, leaving her with limited social support outside of institution. She also, because of the high publicity with her case, as I understand it, is regularly contacted by various people looking to establish a relationship, whether it's just as a friendship, check-in, or potentially even a romantic relationship. And she is an individual who has been isolated and has developed some relationships with people who, frankly, have been nice to her.
Is there any negative impact of those kinds of relationships?
There is. The institutional records, and she even has some burgeoning insight into this, suggest that it's been difficult to identify the motives of some of these individuals. Certainly there have been people who have tried to establish a relationship for their own gain, trying to capitalize on the notoriety of this particular index offense. She also has described that she has maintained some of these relationships because it fits various needs of hers, one being that she's isolated and lonely, but also that some of these individuals are willing to help provide her with things that she otherwise wouldn't have access to. So there have been concerns about navigating the complexity of that, and there, I believe that that's a very complicated topic, and she has done her best to try to navigate that, but it is really difficult, especially given the nature of her institutionalization.
Would navigating that be something that it might be helpful to try to address during, like, a therapy session, therapeutically?
I would think so, yes.
Did you note that at the time of your interview with Ms. Geyser, she had recently stopped the therapy that she was in at Winnebago?
Yes, so the description was that she had met with her proposed case manager that she would have if granted conditional release, and that particular individual had raised, pretty bluntly, raised concerns about at least one relationship that she had, and essentially told her that she wouldn't be allowed to continue that relationship if she were granted conditional release, that the case manager would not support that. And she accepted that feedback and then appropriately made efforts to essentially withdraw her contact with the individual.
In terms of her willingness to comply with therapy at Winnebago, did that end close in time to your interview with her?
I don't know that I can say that it ended. There, around the time of our interview, she was notified that the therapist that she had been working with was no longer available. She, in our interview, made a number of remarks that suggested unhappiness with the quality of care that she had been getting in her therapy, and was looking forward to potential options that may exist within the community that she did not believe to be available to her at Winnebago. There was, when notified that her therapist was no longer going to be available to her, there was a, as I understand it, they asked if she would like to be connected to a new therapist, and at that point, she had indicated that she didn't believe she needed further intervention.
Did Ms. Geyser bluntly deny that she ever benefited from the meetings with that therapist?
With me during our interview, she did make those comments. She's made other comments through the records, though, suggesting that she has, in fact, enjoyed therapy and has benefited from it at times.
Did she disparage the therapist during your interview and her credentials?
She did.
Did Ms. Geyser explain to you that there's nothing more for her to learn at Winnebago?
She did.
Do you believe that's true?
I don't.
Do you think that that belief makes her a risk in the community?
In and of itself, that doesn't make her a risk in the community. The resistance that she has displayed across time to the interventions that are available to her and her tendency to come at those with a pretty negative attitude, it raises concerns about, one, her insight and her judgment, but then also about her motivations and willingness to comply with interventions available to her in the community. So there's a pattern that has been noted across years of her institutional course of being resistant to different, whether it's medical or therapeutic interventions that have been proposed to help benefit her in various ways.
Did you have the opportunity to, are you familiar with the FAM, F-A-M?
Yes.
And what is that?
So it's a adjunct to a structured, it's for structured professional judgment, an instrument that we use called the HCR-20 when doing risk assessments. Essentially what that is, that particular instrument, is it is a clinical guide that includes a number of risk factors and protective factors, both static or unchanging and dynamic or changing, to help a clinician in a conditional release evaluation or a violence risk assessment consider empirically based issues. The FAM is an adjunct for that particular instrument where it includes empirically identified factors that are specific to women.
Did you use those instruments in this case?
I did.
And could you explain what you believe those showed you?
If I can just back up here. So when completing these particular instruments, I want to be clear that it's not a psychological test. There's no cutoff. It's not like a person scores this amount and she's a danger versus scores under that and is not a danger. That's not how this works. It essentially just guides the clinician to be able to consider these different factors that we know have been linked to risk for violence. She has a number of historical factors that exist. So those are unchanging. Nothing we can do about that. But she does have a number of those where she meets in full. When looking at the clinical factors, which are those dynamic or changing and can, they wax and wane across time, it's my opinion that she continues to meet a number of those fully or partially as well. There's a lot of different factors there, so I don't know if you want me to speak to anything in particular, but most concerning to me was that at this point, those clinical items, those dynamic factors, they remain prevalent. So these factors that we know through the literature enhance a person's risk for aggression or violence, several of those remain in full.
Now, I think I know the answer to this, but is this tool the only thing that you used in forming your opinion today?
No.
Okay. But ultimately, you did form an opinion that Ms. Geyser is not ready for conditional release. Is that true?
Correct.
And that she's a risk?
Correct.
And why do you think that?
So taking all of that information together that we've talked about and everything included in my report, but what we know about Ms. Geyser is that she comes to the court with a very serious, violent offense. Concerning at this point is that there has been uncertainty raised regarding how she came to come to that particular violent offense. So it's hard to predict without having a better understanding of that past history of violence. It's hard to predict the future. Of more concern to me, though, is that throughout the records, she continues to be an individual who experiences prominent symptoms of mood instability, very much trauma-specific or characteristic symptoms. Those remain influential on a daily basis for her and have compromised her ability to withstand even the stressors within that close supportive environment of the institution. And I have concerns of if she's having a hard time with her symptoms currently in the community, she's going to be facing stressors that are potentially significantly more complicated, and she won't have direct access to her treatment providers, who at this point are closely monitoring her and intervene almost immediately when she's experiencing distress.
And doctor, do you hold all the opinions you've given today to a reasonable degree of professional certainty?
I do.
Those are all the questions I have.
All right, thank you. Now it's almost 4:30. I'm assuming cross will be somewhat lengthy. Thank you. I had just a note. I had signed an order that authorized civilian clothes for Ms. Geyser.
Great. So then tomorrow she has clothes here. So hopefully tomorrow the jail can make sure she's in those.
Oh, all right. Wasn't the order promulgated?
It was. It just seemed to not have been followed. We filed another one also requesting no shackles tomorrow. That should be in your queue. But also reiterating civilian clothes tomorrow.
Yeah, well, just on the issue of shackles and cuffs, I leave that to the discretion of the sheriff.
Okay.
As to if they believe that's appropriate, that's appropriate. If they don't believe it's appropriate, then they stay on.
Okay.
But certainly civilian clothes, I authorize that. Very good. Thank you. We'll be in recess in the 9 a.m. Thank you, doctor. Have a good afternoon and evening.
Thank you. You too. I hope you feel better.
Thank you. Me too.
There's a lot going around right now.
I know it.
I might come right here. So I'll drop that.